Welcome back. Believe it or not, we're still talking about functionalism as a theory of minds. It's a big topic. In fact, it's not too misleading to say that the refining and evaluation of various versions of functionalism has been the main preoccupation in philosophy of mind and cognitive science since the 1960s. Next week, we're going to turn our attention to a detailed version of functionalism that merges the considerations we've been discussing with some considerations from evolutionary biology. I think that's probably how it's going to go. We can't expect to have a decisive answer that covers every kind of functionalism in philosophy any more than you can expect to have one decisive answer to, say, whether parliamentary republicanism is a good political system. What you'll need to do is look at each example in detail and consider its pros and cons. The answer isn't going to come at the level of isms. That being said, there are some general strategies that one can use when evaluating versions of functionalism, so let's look at a few of those. I've picked four. First, let's consider the problem that philosopher Ned Block calls the problem of inputs and outputs. In order for functionalism to do its job of letting us have our cake and eat it too, we have to be able to give or discover the functional roles of mental states so that they fall in the middle of the continuum between the identity theory and behaviorism. If the functional roles are too concrete and specific, then only one kind of thing will be able to realize those functions, and the result will be a theory that's no more general than the identity theory. This kind of functionalism would be, in Block's terms, chauvinist. It would attribute mental states to too few things. On the other hand, if the functional roles are too abstract or too general, then they can be filled by anything at all. As we've noted before, it shouldn't turn out that a stone or a can of beets should count as having beliefs and desires. A theory that said that would assign mental states to too many things. The problem of inputs and outputs is the challenge of finding a version of functionalism that balances concreteness and generality. We need a solution that's relatively natural and objective, not ad hoc or post hoc. So it's not just a matter of coming up with some description that we can apply. We need to figure out what degree of abstraction is appropriate for psychology. This brings us to the second problem, which I'll call the problem of functional duplication. One way to think about functionalism, which I encouraged when we discussed the novel Fall or Dodge in Hell, is in terms of duplication, in terms of what has to be duplicated or preserved in order to duplicate or preserve the mind or the person. For any duplication, there's a concern that there could be false duplicates that don't duplicate the mental states of the original. If so, then functionalism is the wrong theory of the mental. Two kinds of false duplicates have been especially worrying for the critics of functionalism. On the one hand, what if there was a functional duplicate of me whose experiences and beliefs were exactly inverted, reversed, compared to mine? Where I see blue, he sees yellow. Where I see red, he sees green. My functional twin's experiences are inverted relative to mine. If that's possible, then functionalism is the wrong theory because functional duplication does not guarantee mental duplication. This is called the problem of inverted qualia. Qualia are supposed to be the phenomenal properties of our experiences, the basic units of conscious sensation, just as quanta would be the basic units of physical quantitative properties like mass. Another worrying kind of duplicate is one that's a functional twin of me, but that lacks mental states or some kinds of mental states altogether. Maybe my twin has beliefs, but when I experience the color of a ripe orange, he has no sensations at all. Of course, he still says, "Wow, what a lovely ripe orange," because his functional organization is still hooked up in the right way to his behavior. But in fact, whereas I have sensations, he does not. This is often called the problem of absent qualia. And more recently, it's been common to discuss such examples as cases of so-called philosophical zombies, creatures that are exactly functionally or even physically duplicates of ourselves, but that lack conscious experience altogether. The problems of absent and inverted qualia are special cases of the problem of inputs and outputs. How can functionalists account for exactly the right functional structure of the mind so as to include all and only the right mental states, not exclude any, and also not allow for any false functional duplicates? Another problem that's been very prominent is the problem of causal exclusion. This one is vexed, but it's easy to explain the general idea. Suppose that functionalism is true. Then, in the case of humans like us, there are brain events that realize mental events. And those brain events cause subsequent brain events, which themselves realize mental events, and so on. But according to functionalism, some mental events are also causes of subsequent mental events and subsequent brain events, and so on. On the one hand, because brain events cause one another, it might look like there's no causation left for the mental events to do. All the causation has been, as it were, already done. This looks like it leads to a form of epiphenomenalism. But if we set that aside and allow that mental events are causes, then it looks like we might have too many causes. Any mental event or brain event is caused by a prior brain event and by a prior mental event. So every mental and brain event is causally overdetermined. But neither of these alternatives seems plausible. Mental epiphenomenalism and mental overdetermination. What do we do? There are many potential answers to the problem of causal exclusion, but no general consensus about which one is the best one. Finally, some philosophers, like me, think that the actual evidence for multiple realization is much weaker than people like Hilary Putnam supposed. It's not that we don't think that dogs, birds, or octopuses have mental states, quite the contrary. But we think that, as we've learned more about neuroscience than Putnam knew over 50 years ago, we've gotten increasingly good reasons to think that the brains of mammals, birds, and octopuses are more similar than functionalists expected them to be. In short, brains are much less like human-made computers than Putnam thought they would be, even if it turns out that they do quite a few computations. So, someone like me thinks that when we examine the things for which we have good evidence that they have mental states, they turn out to have important similarities, and in particular, important similarities in their brains. Consequently, we think the evidence for alien, alternative, and artificial minds is much weaker than people thought it would be in the heyday of artificial intelligence in the 1960s and 70s. But just like any other claim that depends on evidence, the critique of multiple realization could turn out to be wrong. Philosophers like me don't deny that there could be evidence for functionalism. We just deny that we have that evidence, or that we have reasons to expect that we're going to get that evidence in the immediate future. Here, as elsewhere, we're probably not going to find the answer at the level of textbook isms. That's just a way of organizing theories and approaches. Next week, we're going to look at one version of functionalism in a bit more detail.